another episode of The World Beyond Belief, episode 126. I'm your co-host, Mindy Erkin, and with me today, as always, is your host, Paul Marco.
Hi there. Welcome back to another thrilling episode of World Beyond Belief. Today is just a great program because it's all good news. It's probably the most gruesome good news ever, but it's about good news, things that are happening, things that are breaking free and benefiting mankind. We're going to start off by, I want to turn you on to a new movie about Sandy Hook, Sandy Hook hoax. I'm going to encourage you to try to see it, although it's heavily censored. And then later on, probably the end of the first hour, the beginning of the second hour, we'll really get into talking about the new revelations that came out, the CIA torture documents, and what that means. I think it's a major, major, major breakthrough, and it represents a great opportunity. But we're going to get into that a little bit later. But let's start off with the Sandy Hook hoax. As you know, I follow a group of independent journalists that gives us news that I present here. I plagiarize and present here every week. These guys are amazing. So what happened is they had all gotten involved with Sandy Hook, the Sandy Hook psy-op, the killing of the supposed killing. Well, they all had done different work on that particular event, and they were all still very interested. So they all got together, and they put together all of their findings so far, and delved even deeper. So they came out with this most incredible film. I mean, it's as close to a smoking gun as you can get on the Sandy Hook hoax. They presented it, and the name of it is We Need to Talk About Sandy Hook. We Need to Talk About Sandy Hook. That's the name of it. Now, they've already taken it off of YouTube. It's the most highly censored video ever. They've already taken it off of YouTube. They've already taken it off of Vimeo. We had to find it through archive.org. Archive.org. I don't know whether you're aware of that, but that's a good site to find video clips of this and that, and they're all, or mostly, are copyright free, so they're free, fair use free.
Creative Commons.
So if you get a chance, I'm going to encourage you to go and see, or try to see somehow, We Need to Talk About Sandy Hook. Now, one of the guys that is with this group of journalists and helped put together this film is a guy that calls himself Jeff C. And I'm going to let him, he's so entertaining. I want him to say a little bit about this new film, We Need to Talk About Sandy Hook.
We are a mere 4 days away from the anniversary, right? The second year anniversary. And you know they're going to milk it for all it's worth. You know that all the articles are coming out in the media and the fund drives and the donate. The attacks, of course, on the film that we did, We Need to Talk About Sandy Hook. And here I want to bring your attention to Peter Klein's website here, Tyranny News Network. He has just put up this sensational article talking about this. Look at this. Sandy Hook documentary phenomenon isn't about Sandy Hook, the fortress and what's inside. And, you know, he starts off explaining all the why we put this together, what we were hoping to achieve, you know, and then, of course, gets into what has happened since the video has been released. In my opinion, it's the most censored video in internet history. And we have been attacked. There has been numerous false copyright claims, videos taken off of all different platforms like Vimeo. Of course, we know Google's all on board. The false claims that are coming in from satanic scumbags like Lenny Posner and the Honor Network, the H-O-N-R. They can't spell it right because they have no honor. And all these false claims, which they could very well go to jail for, and they really should because they have no claims whatsoever on any of the work that we've done. and they've censored many of my videos and taken down some of my most important work, which, you know, will be back up soon enough, but they want to take it down for now. They want to find out everything about us. They want to shame us. They want to do public humiliation. They want to make videos. So Peter goes through how, you know, the performance was just skyrocketing, you know, getting 60, 100,000 views in a couple days on the video. And then, it, of course, it was just ripped right out. And you can see here all the amazing comments that are coming in, how many people are just blown away by the film, and the reviews on places like Internet Movie Database, and overwhelmingly positive reviews. And then, of course, more of the censorship, the coordinated attempts to totally silence this film. People like our friends like Dutch Synths being censored, their channels being shut down, just because they have the courage, not the courage, the courage to stand up and call a spade and give support to this film. This filthy network here run by Lenny Posner, the Honor Network, are the lowest form of humanity. I mean, it's just unbelievable how disgusting these people are. They are truly subhumans, and they will pay in this life or the next for the crimes that they are committing right now, plus the biggest crime of all, which is the whole psy-op false flag hoax, which is Sandy Hook. All right, and people like C.W. Wade, well, no wonder you don't show your face, C.W., you know, and he goes through everything here showing how all this censorship, all these attacks, what they're trying to do. They're trying to attack our personal character, you know, these ad hominem attacks, these, you know, it's just total logical fallacies. It's just awful what they're up to, and, you know, it is a very serious matter. They are lying, they are committing fraud, they are doing all kinds of crimes here. And we know who these people are, Leonard P. Osner, or Eliza, or whatever you want to call yourself, right? Elizer. I think Elizer Posner is best for you, Lenny P. Osner, because you are a liar and a scumbag. And this is what's going on. And he gives credit to all the people that put up the video. And most of them, of course, have had it taken down. So please check out this article here. It's really quite fantastic. On Tyranny News Network. I will post the link below. So the documentary, Sandy Hook Promise, the community organization formed in the days following 12/14, will premiere a new documentary tonight at the Helen Mills Theater in New York City. The documentary is part of a comprehensive education effort designed to help parents protect children from becoming future victims of gun violence. What a fucked up world we live in. I mean, seriously, folks. What are the chances of your son or daughter being shot in a classroom? I'd say it's, you know, they've got a much greater chance of being hit by lightning in that fucking classroom. But of course, they are here to program you so that they can take away the guns from the people like they've done in Australia, Scotland, Great Britain, and other parts of the Five Eyes, or the Six Eyes, as I like to call them, and bring in their new world order, right? And this is one of their major psyops that they have enacted in order to do this. So the documentary, What They Left Behind was a steaming pile of fucking bullshit. Chronicles the stories about gun violence and aims to shed light on the underlying issues that allow them to take place. Through these stories, Sandy Hook Promise introduces a new approach that engages and empowers Americans in the prevention of gun violence in our country. You can't make this fucking shit up. These people are so fucking evil. They want you to give up your rights to defend yourself. Now, the directed by Tarek Karam.
Well, that's Jeff C. And if you want to see the rest of that, hear the rest of that video and see it, go to Free Radio Revolution. That's his website. And
it's his YouTube channel.
That's his YouTube channel. So he's easy to find. He's got 36,000 subscribers. A lot of people like him, just like I do. Well, anyway, the bottom line is, I want to really push this We Need to Talk About Sandy Hook video. I watched it the other night, and it's a longie. It's over 2 hours. And they go into such incredible detail. I mean, these guys really did heavy-duty analysis on things that, boy, I'm no detective, but I certainly couldn't explain away. I think they make a really good case. And if you combine that with Sarah Smallstorm. I can't remember, but it's one of those.
Sophia.
Sophia Smallstorm.
Sophia Small Storm.
Right.
Yeah.
She did. It's been quite a while now. Fantastic research on Sandy Hook. I recommend all of her documentaries.
Yeah, if you really want to get into Sandy Hook or turn somebody on to Sandy Hook, I'd probably watch her documentary, followed by the one that Jeff and the other individual journalists put together, We Need to Talk About Sandy Hook.
Yeah.
And, I mean, there's no denying that it's a psy-op. And actually what's happening, they're trying to put together organizations to discredit the hoaxers. By calling the hoaxers, they're calling the people that have uncovered their hoax, the hoaxers. So that's what they do. You know, they switch things around and relabel.
It's like a double cross.
Yeah, it's like a double cross. So that's what they're doing. But anyway, find out for yourself, and if you can find it. We found it on archive.org, but I think it's difficult to find. Oh, at the end, let me tell you about the end. At the end, this film, We Need to Talk About Sandy Hook, ends by these journalists making the case for this has to be the line in the sand where we're going to no longer tolerate these psyops and false flags. We're going to catch you every time. We're going to call you on it every time. And we're going to punish the perpetrators. This has got to be the line in the sand. And you'll never get a situation where someone's caught more red-handed than they are at Sandy Hook. So this has to be the signal for people to stand up, get together, and call them on Sandy Hook. Even if you're in favor of limiting gun use or something, you know, you can't have your government deceiving anybody like this. So you've got to be on the other side for a minute, and then we can haggle one-on-one without the interference of the controllers and figure out what's the right thing to do about firearms. Anyway, any more on Sandy Hook can you think of?
No, actually.
No. That's a fun story because you really get to know the different characters and the different players and who's an actor, and it's fascinating. But anyway, what I really wanted to spend most of, I think that Sandy Hook stuff is good news because it's coming out. They're running scared. They're trying to censor this video. They're not going to keep it under wraps. They're not going to be able to keep it under wraps. And that's really good news to me because I think that the more people that see that, the more people are going to wake up, and our army will get bigger and bigger, the people that are awakening. So I think that's really good news. Well, the other piece that I want to cover today is also incredibly good news. The CIA was forced somehow to account for what's been going on in their black op sites for a while now. And they published a report, a 6,000-page report that was cut down to 500 pages for the perusal of the Congress and the general public now. It's dubbed the CIA torture documents. And it's the most amazing thing because all the things that we were saying, or we actually knew in our hearts that was actually going on there, well, they were going on there. And you can bet if we're allowed to see it, no matter how horrible this document is, how horrible these atrocities are, it's not as bad as they really are. Because this is how they do it. This is how they mislead. This is a really common tactic that we all need to be aware of and keep watching for all the time. What they'll do as they'll put out news on an event or put out, oh yeah, this is what's happening. They'll put out a piece of it admitting to what happened. But what's really going on is much, much, much deeper and darker and more hideous. I'll give you an example. The whole child kidnapping, child pedophilia thing is going on. It's happening all the time, all over the world. The magnitude of it is unbelievable. No federal government keeps track of the number of children that are kidnapped every year. So David Icke was doing some research on it. And he called the federal government in Washington to find out how many kids had been kidnapped in, I don't know what year, probably 2009, 2010. It sounds like that's when he would be doing this. And the federal government said, we don't track that, of course. So he started calling the state governments and asking them how many reported cases of kidnapping there were that year. And after calling 10 states, he stopped because the number was so overwhelming. It's incredible. Kidnapping and pedophilia all around the world is rampant. It's rampant for a bunch of reasons that I'm not going to go into right now. But it's a horrible tragedy. And what happens in the newspaper or on TV is they'll come out and tell you about a kid that was kidnapped. Or a John Benet Ramsey.
Mm-hmm.
You were right around that case, weren't you? You were in Colorado.
Mm-hmm. I was.
It's amazing. Blown out of, proportion. It was a horrible case. It was a big deal in the news for, it seemed like years.
Mm-hmm.
And that was one kidnapping. Well, that's what they do. They give you one piece.
Well, that was actually a murder, but how it's related is because she was involved in nefarious, situation, according to the family, right? And she was a little beauty queen.
She was.
Right.
So it's related.
Mm-hmm, very much so.
And
but
then,
that's what they do. They give you one sensational case. So, they're not denying it's happening, but there's no news about how...
The magnitude.
Yeah, the magnitude of it.
Yeah, it's really something. Well, the CDC just did it, my favorite organization, the CDC. They just admitted that the flu shot this year didn't work. Now,
why would they do that?
Well, because the flu shot maybe didn't work in all the other years, or maybe they're trying to be honest, and by admitting to the flu shot not working, all the stuff they're doing with the MMR vaccine that's causing autism will kind of go away, I mean, they'll let you know, we fucked up. The flu thing didn't work this year. We're just your honest CDC hanging out here. Meanwhile, what's in the back? So I think the CIA document, even though it's 6,000 pages long and they say it's incriminating as hell, I bet this doesn't scratch the surface.
But let me just stop you for a minute, because, a lot of our listeners might not know about the MMR thing that you just referred to and the connection to autism. I mean, just a quick...
Okay, that's good. Thank you. What happened is, around the year 2000... there's a type of vaccine called the MMR vaccine. And they wanted to find out whether it was safe to give to children. It was a vaccine. And so they did some studies in the year, say, 2002, 2003, and published in 2004 that said there weren't any adverse impacts by giving these vaccines. Well, now we find out through a couple whistleblowers, one who actually had his name on this report, that really that wasn't true, that there was an adverse impact on brain development in black boys. The black boys were a lot more susceptible to becoming autistic if they took this vaccine. And here's the deal. They're still giving it. They're still advocating it. They haven't said anything about it. The people that are walking in with their children, black or white, are still getting this after this falsified report. So Yeah, I'll admit to the flu shot doesn't work this year. See, that's how it's
just
done.
Just a little diversion.
Right. That's just how we, that's how we roll here with the cabal. Well, you know, I was looking at all these things, and I've known about black ops sites. I've been following that pretty closely. And you know that this CIA report is especially amazing because I think it represents the admission of crimes against humanity. And this is a big deal. This is a big deal internationally. They, from 1907, the Hague Convention started outlawing these things called crimes against humanity. And they've been updated and used and agreed upon. They were even used in the Nuremberg trials to try the Nazi, the Nazis. And by that time, it was, here's a definition of crimes against humanity. Crimes against humanity: murder, extermination, enslavement, deportation, and other inhumane acts committed against civilian populations before or during the war, or persecutions on political, racial, or religious grounds in execution of or in connection with any crime within the jurisdiction of the tribunal, whether or not in violation of the domestic law of the country where it was perpetrated. So that covers a lot of ground. I mean, murder, extermination, enslavement. And it's been used time and time again. It was used in criminal tribunals down through the years. And I'm going to read you a little bit from this article that I pulled out about crimes against humanity by M. Sharif Bassioni. That's a better pronunciation for this person who wrote this.
Okay.
Anyway, toward the end of the article, it says, to some extent, crimes against humanity overlap with genocide and war crimes. But crimes against humanity are distinguishable from genocide in that they do not require an intent to destroy in whole or part, as cited in the 1948 Genocide Convention, but only target a given group and carry out a policy of, quote, widespread or systematic, that's important to remember, violations. Crimes against humanity are also distinguishable from war crimes that they not only apply in the context of war, they apply in times of war and peace. So we're talking about people, governments, systematically through policy and procedures passed down, systematically exterminate, torture, kill, kidnap. That's a violation of this crimes against humanity. You can't continue that. I'm going to continue with this article. Crimes against humanity have existed in customary international law for over a half a century and are also evidenced in prosecutions before some national courts. Crimes against humanity are also deemed to be part of jus cogens, the highest standing in international legal norms. Thus, they constitute a non-derogable rule. Now, a non-derogable rule is one that can't be taken away of international law. The implication of this standing is that they are subject to universal jurisdiction. That's even around your neighborhood. Meaning that all states can exercise their jurisdiction in prosecuting a perpetrator irrespective of where the crime was committed. It also means that all states have the duty to prosecute or extradite, that no person charged with that crime can claim, quote, political offense exception, end quote, to the extradition. And that states have the duty to assist each other in securing evidence needed to prosecute, in this case, that document. But of greater importance is the fact that no perpetrator can claim, quote, the defense of obedience to superior orders, end quote. And that no statute of limitation contained in the law of any state can apply. In other words, well, we'll get to that. Lastly, no one is immune from prosecution for such crimes, even the head of state. Now, it seems to me you have an international law. You have an international law that dictates the obligation of every state. And what they mean by state is nation or subdivision of that nation. That could be a state like the state of Pennsylvania or Florida. They have the obligation to prosecute people who violate crimes against humanity. It's not a choice. If they have a jurisdiction that has a, you know, their organs of violence like the like an army or a police force, they have to pursue people according to this this crimes against humanity to prosecute them. Okay, so now we've got a document that admits, open and shut to me, crimes of against humanity.
Yeah.
So this should kick in, and it can kick in any time, and it can kick in with anybody. Anybody that was working with this regime that did this could be arrested. In other words, I think it would be easy to see that the psychologists that worked at Guantanamo Bay, when we get into the document, you'll see, the psychologists that worked in Guantanamo Bay are either guilty of crimes against humanity or guilty of conspiring with people to commit crimes against humanity. And I think any local jurisdiction, like Orange County, Florida, could go and arrest that person and put them in prison to stand trial for crimes against humanity. Convene a court. Kevin Annette has been doing incredible work with this all over the world. He's got many of the big high rollers in the cabal really terrified, because he's convened these criminal courts and he's convicted some of these people. They're just awaiting the force to execute that. So this happens all the time. And this, to me, is a pretty open and shut case. Now, I want to explain something to you about people and how large organizations work. I spent my life working in huge organizations, public and private, mostly training managers, coaching managers, in management. So this is kind of my field in a way. Here's how management works. It's a triangular structure where most people are at the bottom, and those people at the bottom report to a fewer number of people on the next level up. In other words, if you have 12 people on the line, you probably have a supervisor they report to. Another 12 people in advertising, they report to an advertising supervisor. Now, the supervisors report to managers. And the same holds true. If you get 12 supervisors, they'll report to one manager. And that it's through that structure that there's accountability. So the supervisor of a certain group is accountable for everything that happens with that group. He or she is responsible for that group. The organization can blame the supervisor for something that went on in their group. They're supposed to know and be responsible for the activities in that group. All right? Mm-hmm. Managers are the same way. They're responsible for the actions of the supervisor under them. They're responsible. They're accountable for that. If something happens with one of those supervisors, the manager's accountable. Mm-hmm. And it goes up through directors in the private sectors, and then there's levels of VPs and executives, and it goes on up. But they're all accountable. And in a corporate structure, other than occasionally a process team, a project team will be put together under a project manager that'll be outside of the structure somewhat. It all falls into this pyramidal structure and accountability. So what I'm saying is, what you're going to be led to believe over the next months as the Congress tries to weasel their way out of being accountable for what went on in the CIA, you're going to hear them talk about, well, this guy didn't know about it, but that guy had plausible deniability, and this guy, he was really in charge, so he's the one that should go, but the rest of these guys, really, that's not how it works. If you do something and you report to somebody, they're your handler, your supervisor, your manager, your director, they're responsible for what you do, and they need to know what you do. If they don't, they're incompetent. And they should suffer the consequences of an incompetent by being held accountable for something they didn't even know was going on. Management, it's pretty strict. The top guy's responsible for everything. Whether he allowed himself to know it, there's evidence in these documents that Bush, George W. Bush, purposely excluded himself from meetings about this subject, probably to claim plausible deniability. That doesn't get you out of it, George. You're responsible for your underlings. That's just the way it is. If you didn't know about it, shame on you, man. You should have known about it. You should have asked somebody. You should have stopped the damn thing, although I know you and your ilk started the whole thing. All right, so my first encounter with this story was actually with the New York Times, oddly enough. I came across it online. I don't read the New York Times. I think it's, you know, the, it's not credible for me. Anyway, I see that this thing, report portrays a broken CIA devoted to a failed approach. And this goes into how the CIA got the report. In January 2003, 10 months into the Central Intelligence Agency's secret prison program, the agency's chief of interrogations sent an email to colleagues saying that the relentlessly brutal treatment of prisoners was a train wreck. Quote, waiting to happen, and I intend to get the hell off the train before it happens, end quote. He said, and he told his bosses he had serious reservations about the program and no longer wanted to be associated with, quote, in any way. The bitter infighting at the CIA interrogation program was only one symptom of the dysfunction, disorganization, incompetence, greed, deception, described in a summary of the Senate Intelligence Committee's report. In more than 500 pages, the summary released Tuesday paints a devastating picture of an agency that was ill-equipped to take on the task of questioning Al-Qaeda suspects, bungled the job, and then misrepresented the results. Okay, I guess the American people are really interested in, like, how their money's spent, you know? How these guys were a little bit incompetent, and why isn't the report totally directly focusing on the victims of their action? You know, I can remember this same thing. I used to do a lot of traveling, and I belonged to Delta's, I don't know, Commodore Club or whatever it was. And I used to go in there and grab a coffee before getting on the flight, but on the build-up to the Iraq War, I noticed that everybody just wasn't sitting around. They were watching TV because they were really interested in the war. And they were interested in how the war affected their stocks. They were interested in how they should be transferring their money from one way to another. And it just made me so sick. Nobody seemed to even report on the kids in Iraq, the kids that couldn't get out of the city of Baghdad. Nobody seemed really interested in that. So I stopped going into that lounge. I couldn't take it anymore. Goes on to say, the Senate report is the most sweeping condemnation of the CIA since the Church Committee, when led by Senator Frank Church of Idaho, when he accused the agency in the 1970s of domestic spying, botched assassinations, and giving LSD to unwitting subjects. I guess the Frank Church Committee didn't realize that the CIA was absolutely involved also in the Kennedy assassination. But I guess that hadn't been ferreted out yet. Anyway, it goes on to say the report said that the agency had evidently forgotten its own conclusion, sent to Congress in 1989, that said, quote, inhumane physical or psychological techniques are counterproductive because they do not produce intelligence and will probably result in false answers, end quote. The Democratic Senate staff members who studied the post-9/11 program came up with an identical assessment that waterboarding, wall slamming, nudity, cold, and other ill treatment produced little information of value in preventing terrorism. And that's the bottom line. So we're still not talking about people. We're still not talking about the actual process of waterboarding and what that would feel like. And what that would cause you to do. We're still talking about, well, they told us it would result, it didn't result, reveal the results, we thought. I mean, geez, does it take a psychologist to tell someone that when you torture someone, they're going to tell you whatever they need to tell you to get you to stop fucking torturing them? I mean, I am a psychologist and I know that. What about you, Min?
Yeah, I know that too.
So the rest of the article starts talking about how they're passing the buck to different people. And they do go into one little idea of what was actually going on. It was the torture and murder of Gul Rahman. He was found dead of hypothermia at the Salt Pit, CIA detention site in Afghanistan. Credit Habib Rahman, Associated Press. I'm going to go into that particular site. That was the dark site. They never turned on lights. And the guys, they gave them rectal exams. So, well, this is, I don't want to get in myself because I'm going to do this in the second hour, but anyway. And Dr. Mitchell and Dr. Jensen, identified by the pseudonyms Grayson Swigert and Hammond Dunbar on the report. Grayson Swigert, that's a good pseudonym, had not conducted a single real interrogation. They had helped in a Cold War era training program for the Air Force in which personnel were given a taste of harsh treatment they might face if captured by communist enemies. And it goes on, and it talked about how the program allowed psychologists to assess their own work. They gave it excellent grades and to charge a daily rate of $1,800 each day, four times the pay of other interrogators to waterboard detainees. Dr. Mitchell and Dr. Jensen later stated a company that took over the CIA program from 2005 until it was closed in 2009. The CIA paid it $81 million plus $1 million to protect the company from legal liability. All right. Well, anyway, the Salt Pit goes on to describe the Salt Pit.
Yeah.
The Salt Pit, the junior officer ordered a prisoner, Gul Rahman, shackled to a wall of his cell and stripped of most of his clothing. Mr. Rahman was found dead of hypothermia the next morning, lying on the bare concrete floor. 4 months later, the junior officer was recommended for a cash award of $2,500 for his, quote, consistently superior work. A CIA accountability board later recommended disciplinary action against one of the officers involved in the death at the Salt Pit, but in that instance and another, the board was overruled. The director strongly believes that mistakes should be expected in a business filled with uncertainty.
A business filled with uncertainty.
I mean, a business filled with uncertainty is like the retail shoe business. You don't know whether, I mean, or the retail, some kind of exotic shrimp business. You don't know whether it's going to come in, people are going to buy it. But this is the...
torture business.
This is the torture business.
You just can't be sure if you'll get reliable information, no matter what.
No matter how you pay these villains.
You deliver.
In 2001, the agency had proposed meeting United States prison standards, but the guidelines approved by Mr. Tennant were so minimal that they were met even by the Salt Pit, where detainees were kept shackled in complete darkness and isolation, with a bucket for human waste and without notable heat in the winter. And they also admitted that they're holding in a lot of their sites. They said, we made the unsettling discovery that we're holding a number of detainees about whom we know very little. So that's the New York Times coverage.
Unbelievable.
And that's the paper of record. So that's what most of your brothers and sisters throughout the Western speaking world are going to believe is happening, and it's appalling because, well, they were wasting money because it wasn't getting the results, and it was embarrassing people, and, we don't know who's really accountable, and it was costing a lot of money, so that's really the bad part. To me, that ain't the bad part. To me, the bad part is when you torture someone, when you waterboard them. You know what that is, that waterboarding thing?
No.
Okay, from what I've never undergone it or done it that I can remember. From the pictures I've seen of people doing it, you're strapped to a board. Mm-hmm. And the board is probably slightly tipped on the feet end.
It means your head's down?
So your head's a little lower. Uh-huh. You're, of course, strapped down so your arms can't move. Your head can't move back and forth, and you can't move. Mm-hmm. And then you put a towel over your face, mm-hmm. and they dump water up your nose.
Oh.
That's your American tax dollars of work. I mean, you've got to be, geez.
I guess I thought they dunked your whole head in the water.
I don't think that's the way, but maybe. I mean, you know as much about
either
this
way,
as...
Either way, it's horrible.
Like, you mean holding you underwater to you?
Yeah.
Yeah, maybe they...
I don't know.
I'm not really really up to date on water.
No, I'm sure I don't have any idea. You have much more idea than I do, so I'm sure you're right.
Anyway, that's what we do. And I'm going to go on to another article about the same subject. It's from Zero Hedge. And from Zero Hedge, you get a little bit more actual news coverage, and they tell it like it is.
Mm-hmm.
Excuse me. Called We Tortured Some Folks. CIA Lied to Congress, Senate Torture Report Reveals. In what we are confident everyone will find to be absolutely shocking news, moments ago, the Senate torture report was released. The key finding, hold on to your hats, is that the CIA misled Congress. That's a word that they use for lied. That's misled. Called misled.
Yeah. Makes it sound like it's not such a big deal.
Right. As for the timing of the release, which takes place at the same time as the Jonathan Gruber PhD is being grilled in the House, it's hardly a coincidence that Obama does everything in his power to deflect attention to what took place under the Bush administration, commenting that, quote, torture techniques did significant damage to America's standing, end quote, in the world. So what did the droning of thousands of innocent civilians do the same to that same standing? Yes. Okay. So I underlined some things to drill down from Bloomberg. We know that the CIA provided inaccurate information about the effectiveness. Interrogation techniques weren't effective, didn't produce key information that led to the killing of Osama bin Laden, and were significantly different from the procedures authorized by the Justice Department, report says. Okay, this looks fishy to me. Wonder which killing of bin Laden they're talking about. And I wonder whose ass they're covering by significantly different from procedures authorized. So that could be interesting.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Agency lost track of 119 detainees, and at least 26 didn't meet standards for being held, according to the executive summary. In the fall of 2002, detainee died of hypothermia while shackled to concrete floor. Another detainee was held for 17 days in the dark without anybody knowing he was there. Interrogation of terrorism suspect Abu Zubaydah, who was waterboarded at least 83 times, was more brutal than previously known. At one point, he was put in a 1.5 meter box and knocked unconscious during waterboarding session, while water and bubbles poured from his mouth. Wow. Other detainees with broken legs and feet were inappropriately forced to sit in stress positions. No evidence CIA briefed former President George W. Bush about harsh interrogations, though former Vice President Dick Cheney attended meetings where tactics were discussed. Just because you don't know about it, if it happens in your group, which is federal government for George W. Bush, hey, you tag, you're it, man. So the fact that he wasn't doesn't mean a thing. I'd go right after him if I were you guys. Okay. CIA torture relief set for Senate release over Bush objectives. The full Senate Intelligence Committee wasn't briefed on techniques until September 2006. I think this whole thing about Bush weaseling out is just plausible deniability. Goes on to say, White House officials repeatedly resisted having the CIA debrief cabinet-level figures about the details, and CIA officials were not permitted to brief Bush directly until mid-2006, where more than 4 years after the president signed a broad executive order authorizing the program. He authorized the program, according to the Senate Democratic aides, who briefed reporters ahead of today's release. When Bush finally heard the details of the harsh interrogation techniques that were used against CIA detainees, he was, quote, uncomfortable with some of them and expressed dismay that some detainees were required to remain in stress positions for long amounts of time to the point that they had no choice but to soil themselves. The aide said, well, I can imagine where Bush would identify with that, because I'm sure he was in a stress position for 8 years And he probably soiled himself more than once. I mean, with his... Goes on to say, Powell and Defense Secretary Donald Rumsfeld were briefed on the interrogation technique sometimes in 2003. The committee report states, other top officials, including Vice President Dick Cheney and National Security Advisor Condoleezza Rice, also eventually received briefings about the details of the program, but not the president himself. Oh man, he's not going to get out of it that easily. All of a sudden, in my country, the United States of America, I was really shocked to find out that George Bush had authorized torture. When I was a little boy, I remember, I was a little boy, but I wasn't a little tough boy. I was a little kind of sissy kind of boy. So a lot of times we'd get beat up, you know, or you'd get roughed up or, you know.
You and your geeky friends?
Me and my geeky friends. And actually what saved us most of the time is we were so frail that I'm sure these bullies thought that...
Easy target.
Oh, no, we can hurt these guys so badly that we'll get in trouble.
Oh, I think so they let you alone.
So it wasn't so hard. But I can remember being held down by my feet and legs and a guy sitting on my chest. I must have been 6, 7 years old. And they were dropping these little peas that they'd picked off a tree on my eyeballs. And I was thinking, during this thing. My dad had told me that torture was illegal under the Geneva Convention. And that I lived in a world free of torture. And I thought to myself, wow, this is just like torture. This is horrible. I can't even move my body. And they're doing this to me. But thankfully, because of people who went before me, because of grown-ups and people that fought wars, that we didn't have this kind of atrocity happening anymore. And I can remember that as if it was yesterday.
Yeah, you've told me that story before.
So, anyway, so we're back into torture. So here I am. It's 2000, 2001, 2002. What did I say? 2002 or 3. He authorized torture. In my country, not just a badass country like North Korea or somebody, you know, some horrible Middle Eastern country under Shia law where they do draconian things anyway. No, this is my country. This is the country that, you know, supposedly led the world in freedom. So that was a shock to me.
Yeah. I remember how upset you were when he legalized torture and you found out.
So it goes on to say the program was authorized. The agency did not want to proceed without authorization. It was also reviewed legally by the Justice Department before they undertook the program. And that was an interesting review, I bet. So here, in response to the committee's report, the CIA states that it is unknowable whether or not Bush was briefed on the details of the program prior to 2006 because CIA records are incomplete on the point. Rizzo, in his memoir, Company Man, states that Bush probably wasn't fully briefed on the details. But George W. Bush, in true Bush fashion, snatches defeat from victory by writing in his own memoir that he was briefed on the details. So there you go. I mean, he should be picked up on some charge. I don't know. Stupidity, maybe.
There's so many.
But you see, this program happened for years and years. And everybody's involved. I mean, Obama can't say it was Bush's program because he didn't stop it. He didn't repeal it. Actually, he extended it.
Did he say he was going to close down Guantanamo Bay when he took office?
Yeah.
That was one of his promises, wasn't it?
Yeah, he probably thought it was Kingston Bay in Jamaica or something. I mean, he certainly was working for the globalists from the beginning. He's working for the globalists since he was a teenager.
Right.
So he certainly knew what he was doing, and he certainly knew he didn't intend to shut that down. Anyway, mm-hmm. So yeah, he did say that. But you can't grant, you can't, the Congress isn't going to hang for this, because the Congress isn't going to take any action against anybody, because they're all culpable for this. Mm-hmm. They're all involved. They're all in bed. There's nobody that couldn't have blown the whistle. There's nobody that couldn't have really said this has got to stop. So they're all in collusion. And now, if the police forces throughout the country and the military doesn't enforce this crimes against humanity, they're culpable too. So everybody is culpable in this big crime against humanity, and it gets worse and worse. It spirals down and down. After I read some more of this stuff, you're not going to believe how spiraling down and down it, how down and down it gets. But it's really deplorable stuff. Well, this looks like a good time to take a little break from all the CIA and torture stuff. Let's listen to some music.
Okay, we're going to listen to Parov's Dalar, Jimmy's Gang.
Hi, welcome back. That was Parov's Dalar. That thing gets me hopping every time I hear it. I wanted to continue on talking about the CIA torture report. And the first hour I was critical of the New York Times coverage because they were stressing, oh, we lost all that money because we paid people to do it, and it wasn't effective, but they didn't focus enough in on the people. I think that we should really, as witnesses to what's going on, which is what I think we're all enrolled in doing, we need to know what's on. And I've got another article from The Devil's Lair. Inside the CIA's sadistic dungeon. Many of the most shocking scenes recounted in the Senate's torture report all take place in a location known as Cobalt, or the Dark Prison, the Salt Pit, and a dungeon. This is pretty creepy stuff. At the CIA's detention site Cobalt, the lights were never turned on. The site was blacked out at all times with curtains and painted exterior windows. It was this location where some of the CIA's most gruesome detainee abuse occurred, according to the Senate Intelligence Committee's review of the CIA's interrogation programs released on Tuesday. Ultimately, Cobalt housed, at one point or another, nearly half of the 119 detainees identified by the report. The CIA detainment and interrogation program can be, in many ways, told through the story of the hellhole the Cobalt site became, brutal techniques, little oversight, and unchecked abuse in the early years after 9/11. In the name of national security. One of the lead interrogators at Cobalt once said it was an effective place for interrogations because it was the closest he has seen to a dungeon. Detainees who had been through the site, apparently in Afghanistan, called it the Dark Prison, while the agency referred to it as the Salt Pit. Now, knowing that these guys only let out what they have to let out, I have to think that this is probably describing a pretty bad thing, but not the worst. The CIA was alerted of allegations that anal exams at Cobalt were conducted with excessive force. An attorney was asked to follow up, but no records indicate that what happened next. Agency records said that one of the detainees housed at Cobalt, Mustafa Al-Hawsawi, was later diagnosed with chronic hemorrhoids, an anal fissure, and symptomatic rectal prolapse.
That sounds bad.
I think it is bad.
Yeah.
Nude prisoners were kept in a central area and walked around as a form of humiliation. Detainees were hosed down while shackled naked and placed in rooms with temperatures as low as 59 degrees Fahrenheit. Loud music was always constantly played. In one case, a detainee was dragged naked along the floor. Detainee Gul Rahman, clothes were cut off, and CIA interrogators put a hood on Rahman's head. They slapped and punched him, and when he fell, dragged him through the dirt. Rahman was later found dead, with hypothermia, the suspected cause. So, what do you have to do in life? You know, crime equals a punishment. What do you have to do in life to deserve that? Be opposed to U.S. imperialism overseas, to follow the Koran, you have to be pretty bad. I mean, if we're a fair and just state, one senior interrogator said that detainees, quote, go for days or weeks without anybody looking at him, end quote, and that his team found a detainee who had been chained in a standing position for 17 days, as far as we could determine. Here's a man, he stood up for 17 days. Could have been your son. Could have been your father. It was probably somebody's son. Has to be somebody's son, right?
Mm-hmm.
Could have been somebody's father.
Mm-hmm.
He stood for 17 days. Just amazing. Some of the detainees at Cobalt literally looked like a dog. A senior CIA debriefer told the agency's inspector general that she heard stories of detainees at Cobalt hung on days for end with their toes barely touching the ground, choked, being deprived of food, and made the subject of a mock assassination. You know how terrified that can be when they hold you underwater? You know, detainees, they were subject to sleep deprivation, shackled to bars with their hands above their heads. In fact, 4 of 20 cells at Cobalt were found to have bars across the cell to allow this to happen. In 2002, CIA Officer 1 ordered that Gul Rahman's clothing be removed and shackled to the wall such that he could only rest on the concrete floor. The next day, Rahman's dead body was found, and the resuscitation efforts of the CIA employee proved unfruitful. But the guy who murdered him, Officer 1, received a $2,500 cash reward for that.
A reward for his murder.
Yeah.
That's sick.
Self-described 911 mastermind Khalid Sheikh Mohammed was also kept at Cobalt after his March 2003 in Pakistan. Just after a few minutes of questioning at Cobalt, he was subject to enhanced interrogation techniques. He was slapped, grabbed in the face, placed in stress positions, placed in standing sleep deprivation, and doused with water. As a means of total control over the detainee, the then chief of interrogation said KSM, that's Khalid Sheikh Mohammed, was subject to rectal rehydration multiple times, without the determination of medical need. Now, CIA director at the time just came out today and actually was defending the process of anal rehydration. That's where they shoot water up your ass. I mean, quite simply.
Yeah. That's horrible.
But the enhanced interrogations were not effective with KSM, who appeared in the eyes of the interrogation team to clam up after they were used. But adopting a softer Mr. Rogers persona made KSM more cooperative, and according to the team. A senior CIA official later said that the later waterboarding of KSM elsewhere appeared counterproductive, that the CIA had lost ground with KSM since the progress at Cobalt, and that the use of waterboarding may poison the well. So this man was using the Mr. Rogers technique, which I suppose is, you know, welcome to your neighborhood.
Welcome to the neighborhood.
He was giving up information. And it was probably information that was true, but the minute they'd start torturing him, he'd clam up again.
So why do they continue with the torture? Because they're sick bastards and they get off on torturing people.
Yeah. Yeah, I think that's it. I've got a couple articles that seem to say that coming up here. After the funding at Cobalt, a man named Ridha al-Najjar. Now, you can tell by his name that he's one of the guys that's going to be tortured.
Right.
Because he's a Muslim. Was the first to be held at detention site Cobalt. Boy, what a great honor. He had been left hanging by handcuffs and not allowed to lower his arms for 22 hours each day for two consecutive days. What the hell's going on? He was kept in total darkness, kept cold, had music blasted at him, and was shackled and hooded. The CIA Inspector General would later say that al-Najjar became the model for treatment of CIA detainees at Cobalt.
They're sick.
How would you, this happened to you, and you were captured. Let's say you're even somebody who would plot against the United States. I think it's safe to say that most, if not all, of the false flags and terrorist activities have been perpetrated by the CIA. I think that's fair to state. After researching many of them, if there's an exception, send me an email. But I can't think of any. So this person could have been kind of anti-American. So you capture him and you hang him by handcuffs for 22 hours a day for 2 days. Wow. What would you think about America? What would you think about the West? If I wasn't a terrorist then, they better kill me. While Cobalt was one central location for American detainee abuse, it was hardly the sole place to feature what lawmakers and the president have called torture. Detainees were described in a graphic detail, being rectally fed against their will. Oh. Oh. One detainee was bent over for rectal feeding that involved Ensure, the protein shake. Remember I used to take that?
Mm-hmm.
Perhaps I was taking it the wrong way. I didn't mean...
No wonder it didn't work.
And perhaps the most graphic detail of the report, a detainee had his lunch consisting of hummus, pasta, nuts and raisin, pureed, and rectally infused.
They have, like, sick sense of humor in addition to their total mindset.
In addition to the satanic practices that they use. Yeah, I think that as Americans, as human beings, as people in the world, we can't do this. You can't allow this to happen on your watch. These are crimes against humanity. And your humanity. It's not just me. Your humanity. And it's not just these people with the funny-sounding Eastern names. We're all humanity, and crime against humanity is a crime against you. That's why we have to wake up and do something. Look, all you'd really need to do is, if you're, let's say you're a police force in some small town in Georgia, where one of the psychologists that was doing the torture in Guantanamo actually lives. Well, I think it would be an easy thing to arrest him for crimes against humanity, hold him, and he's going to plea, "I was just following orders," which isn't a plea, it's an excuse. But that's what he'd say, and then you could ask what the orders were, and then you go to the next higher level. That way you can get everybody. You want them to stop. The idea is to get them to stop doing this shit. The only way you're going to stop them is to arrest them. I don't care what you do after you arrest them. You can forgive them. But you've got to get them so that they know that they can't continue to do that stuff. It's got to stop now. All right, you were talking about the purpose, perhaps the purpose of this. I've got a Kurt Nemo article. This is from InfoWars. And he says in this article, title of the article is CIA Adopted Nazi and Communist Torture Techniques. And halfway through the article, it says, "This was admitted by Senator Carl Levin, the chairman of the Senate Committee on Armed Services." He said, "In survival, evasion, resistance, and escape training, U.S. troops were briefly exposed in a highly controlled setting to abusive interrogation techniques used by enemies that refused to follow the Geneva Conventions." That's enemies. We might have enemies that don't follow the Geneva Convention. We, of course, don't follow the Geneva Convention. But if we have enemies that don't, we're going to torture them. We're going to not follow the Geneva Convention by torturing them. Okay, Levin remark. I'm going on to his quote. "The techniques are based on tactics used by Chinese communists against American soldiers during the Korean War. Get this. For the purpose of eliciting false confessions for propaganda purposes." So let's go over that a minute. The reason that they were torturing these people was to get false confessions, because the Chinese communists obviously were smart enough to know that you don't get information in this technique, you get false confessions. So they wanted to get false confessions because they can use these false confessions to do war propaganda.
I get it.
So the
CIA must know that before they even began there.
Well, if Kurt Nemo knows it, and that's our intelligence agency, I think you're right. "The technique was used extensively as the Bush neocons hobbled together fabrications used to rationalize the war on terror and provide a pretext for the invasion of Iraq in 2003. Despite what you've seen on TV, torture is really only good at one thing, eliciting false confessions." Dan Fromkin wrote for the Washington Post, quote, "Indeed, Bush-era torture techniques, we know now, were cold-bloodedly modeled after methods used by Chinese communists to extract confessions from captured U.S. servicemen. So torture as a propaganda tool is a required asset for the state. Otherwise, the bottom would fall out of the manufactured war on terror, the latest scam perpetuated by the financial elite and the military-industrial complex." So I think that's pretty telling.
Mm-hmm.
I have one more little group of horrors that might get you motivated to actually do something about this. If you think that this is only happens in faraway black sites over the seas, think again. Defenders of the warfare state insist that such methods are a cruel but necessary tactic in a generational struggle against implacable foreign enemies. After all, quote, we're at war, supposedly, and foreign enemy combatants aren't entitled to due process or the protection of law. That's what people that would be advocating this torture program might say. Although, if anybody's advocating this torture program now and has read just the superficial stuff that I've read, you've got to really change your stance. I'm sorry, but I can't take you any further unless you can change your stance on that. And then it talks about some techniques that are used on Americans in our country, land of the free, home of the brave. The same perspective informs the domestic war on drugs and similar forms of interrogation through torture that have been employed by police on the basis of nothing more than substantive than a hunch. David Eckerd was stopped by police in Deming, New Mexico. You know where that is?
Yeah.
Without cause, subject to an illegal search of his vehicle in person, and eventually forced to undergo what amounts to rape in the form of multiple rectal probes, forced enemas, and a colonoscopy. Mm-hmm. Are we seeing a pattern here?
Yeah.
Is this a pretty...
They're kind of perverted. Well, of course, they'd have to be if they engage in torture, inflicting torture.
But they seem to be really interested in the...
The Stargate.
The Stargate, yeah. I don't know whether you guys know this, but there's an incredibly evil guy that lived around the turn of the 19th, 20th century. His name's Aleister Crowley. And he called himself, the meanest man in the world or the most brutal man in the world. And he supposedly takes credit for 52 murders. And these are murders of young boys who he sodomized before he murdered them. And one of the reasons he was doing this is because he considered it a way to time travel. No, I'm serious. He considered this a way to... He considered these young boys... Tushies to be Stargates. Okay, so maybe these guys are in the Aleister Crowley Club. I don't know. A second man named Timothy Young was also detained by Deming's Anal Probe Patrol.
Deming has an anal probe.
Well, I think
patrol.
They're being facetious. And given
Deming
roughly.
Deming would have one of
those.
He
would, it would.
Because Deming is just a horrible town.
Well, it's a little dry little town. It's got a good dentist.
Well, that's true.
And given roughly the same treatment Eckerd experienced, he was abducted by deputies and taken to Gia National Medical Center for abdominal x-rays and a rectal exam. As in Eckerd's case, this was done without the victim's consent outside the jurisdiction covered in the search warrant. So we have a Deming anal probe patrol. Okay, a third case involved a woman detained. Oh, man.
Are we back in Deming again?
Oh, well, it may not be Deming, but it's in El Paso.
Close by.
A woman involved detained on suspicion of narcotic smuggling while crossing the border in El Paso, Texas. According to an attorney, police took her to a nearby hospital where medical staff observed her making a bowel movement, and no drugs were found at that point. They then took an x-ray, but it did not reveal any contraband. They then did a cavity search, and they probed her vagina and her anus. They described in the medical records as bimanual two-handed.
Oof.
Bimanual two-handed. Finally, they did a CAT scan, and again, they found nothing. Obviously, the victim did not consent to this abuse. Her government-employed kidnappers didn't bother to seek judicial permission slip, sometimes called a warrant, to inflict it on her. This is simply standard procedure in America. So this is why you can't let them get away with it. Do you have a daughter? Do you have a mother?
It could be you.
These anal probing New Mexicans or Texans could be coming after her. I don't want to make light of this because I really think this is a crack in the wall. I think they've admitted to crimes against humanity and now it's time to act. Now, I don't want you to act in violence. I don't want you to act in hate. You're just simply doing the job that you signed up for. And you set up courts and we try these people. Or you ask them to say they're sorry or something. I don't know what the process is after that. But the idea is to get them to stop doing this. You can't do this to people. It's way beyond not cool.
It's completely not acceptable.
Right. Hey, and if you're a policeman, how embarrassed were you when you heard what these other guys were doing? Or women. Who knows whether they were men or women. They were the anal patrol. They probably don't have very high standards. I don't know. Well, you know, one of my favorites is Paul Craig Robertson. He's one of my favorites because he's the previous, I think he's close to the previous hero generation. The guys that fought World War II. Roberts was Assistant Secretary of the Treasury for Economic Policy, associate editor of the Wall Street Journal. He's a columnist for Business Week, Scripps, Howard News Service, and Creator Syndicate. I guess a lot of other people like what he says too. Mm-hmm. But he chimed in this morning and gave his 2 cents on this CIA torture thing. The purpose of the torture program was to produce self-incriminated terrorists to justify and feed the hoax war on terror. The war on terror was public cover for secret agendas that the American people would have rejected. So what this man, member of the Reagan administration, esteemed columnist, member of the establishment is saying is that the war on terror is a hoax. It was a cover. Now, the war on terror is a hoax. Now let's go back to your anal probing, handcuff hanging military overseas. What are they doing? The people that are doing this know that the war on terror is a hoax. They don't have to do this torture. It serves no purpose except getting forced confessions, maybe to justify the war further. I think they're doing it for fun. Anyway, back to Paul Craig. This is disturbing enough. The war on terror was a public cover for secret agendas that the American people would have rejected. This is disturbing enough. Even more disturbing, the torture program shows that no one in the U.S. and European governments who knew of the program and participated in torture has an ounce of humanity, integrity, compassion, and morality. I think that's safe to say.
I do.
They are evil people, and ones who inflicted the torture enjoyed the pain and suffering that they inflicted on others. The only exceptional thing about the U.S. is the extent of the evil that resides in Washington, D.C. Now, that's a good one from Paul Craig Roberts. It's really important that we get this straight. The war on terror is a fraud. All the actions taken, all the people that were killed fighting the war on terror died because they were tricked. It was not like the people in Vietnam weren't tricked to going. I mean, that's just what happens. What I'm saying is that we've got to stop it. It's got to happen right now. If we don't seize on the Sandy Hook hoax, we have to seize on this one. Hey, and there's another one out there. It's the vaccine. Mercury in the vaccines. Nothing's being done about that. They're still injecting those young kids. I believe that this whole system can be brought down. I believe it can be turned around. I think that we just need to do some things. Some things are breaking loose now, and I think that we need, if nothing else, always call the torture program a crime against humanity. Call these things crimes against humanity, because that'll get into the nomenclature. Remember when Boston bombing happened? When the Boston bombing happened, there were a lot of independent journalists and even Alex Jones that was jumping up and down, calling it a false flag. Well, Google had more queries on what the hell is a false flag on that day than they ever did, ever. So people are learning the nomenclature. They need to know what a false flag is. They need to know what a psy-op is. And they need to know what a crime against humanity is. In the Nuremberg trials, they hung people for doing things that weren't any worse than what's happening, what was happening in the CIA interrogation program. And I'll guarantee you, it's still going on. I know it's going on in Guantanamo. I was just reading an article about them using overdoses of malaria medicine to make them sick and complacent month after month. Mm. These are human beings. These are human beings. They're just like the human beings that you work with and your relatives. These are human beings. You have to see them as human beings. If you can't see them as human beings, you're no better than the torturer. You've got to see them as your brother. We're all together in this. It's got to be stopped. Well, I think it can be brought down. One of the reasons is because we've shifted to a positive timeline. Now, I think I've talked about this on the show before, about Alfred Lambermont Weber's positive timeline. He feels that because of several factors, we jump from the negative timeline, which is the duality conscious timeline, where we win, they lose, or we lose, they win. And we jump to a unity consciousness, where we all win timeline. And he says that happened around December 21st, 2012. And he cites incidents after that that seem to confirm the more positive nature of the timeline. I can remember Mindy and I went on a trip in June 2013, and a lot of people were predicting at that time. Now, these were people that weren't just pull it out of your ass projections. These are actual people who worked with the Farsight Institute. We had Cliff High and some other sources that Alfred has were predicting what they call a global coastal event. Now, what was supposed to happen was there was something that happened in the oceans that caused vast amounts of the landmass to be flooded, including taking out Washington, D.C., you know, San Francisco Bay, and all those things. It was a...
Sydney, Australia, completely gone.
Right. Remember they had remote viewers go to these places?
Mm-hmm.
Didn't happen. Didn't even come close to happening. We didn't even get a delayed flight on our trip. Nothing, nada. And then you fast forward a little further, and you realize that the cabal really wanted to go into Syria. It was one of the ones on their list that they gave to Wesley Clark. You know, we want to go here and then this and then this and then this. They couldn't get in. They couldn't get any traction. The parliament in the UK voted it down. Cameron couldn't move forward on it. So actually what happened was Obama started backpedaling. Putin came in and saved the day by offering some type of a compromise. And so Obama got his head out of the sling, but that didn't work out. Since then, they've tried to use Al-Qaeda to attack Syria. They've reinforced it with ISIS. And the more they do, the more the world is against them. Another thing that they always cite was, we're in a period of either four or five blood moons. And these blood moons down through time have been times when the evil forces, the forces of darkness, have been able to manipulate things and get their way. Well, we've had three of the four so far and nothing. Even to the point that people are really recognizing that Israel attacking the Gaza Strip was a crime against humanity. Actually, they've been tried and convicted by international courts for that. They couldn't get any traction on it. It didn't move forward. The Sandy Hook hoax. Again, it's coming out more and more. The more they try to cover it up, I mean, it's a real whack-a-mole thing. It's like the more they try to cover that up, the more evidence is that it's a cover-up. So that's going to fall apart. The whistleblower that came forth on the vaccines with mercury, they've got to come forward. That's going to break the back of the CDC. We've done podcasts where we've talked about all the horrendous things that the CDCs are doing. But it's got to break the back of the CDC. If it doesn't, we're not waking up. We're not doing what we should do. Okay, what were some other things that have happened just lately? This CIA report. They couldn't suppress that any longer. It's like holding a beach ball under a swimming pool. You just can't, under the swimming pool water, you get to know.
Mm-hmm.
It just kept popping up. So they got by with a 500-page report out of a 6,000-page report. But I think that's just a crack in the wall. I think that's going to come down. So I think that we are on the positive timeline.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that taking action in light of confessions, this is the time to do it. The timeline is on your side. We're moving toward a new dawn. Don't let these people torture people anymore. Don't let them inject children with mercury anymore. Don't let them do that. We can stop it. We have the evidence. We have everything. All we need to do is stand up and stop it. And we don't have to do it with violence. We can do it with love. You know, come with me. We'd like for you to answer some questions and tell us about how you're involved with this. That's all you have to do. We have them dead to rights. I think it's an important thing to do right now is to draw all your friends in on all this knowledge. One of the first techniques is to, do kind of what we're doing right here. You can spread this podcast far and wide. It's the more people that hear it, I don't know whether I'm convincing enough, but the more they'll at least be questioning what's happening. They'll get another side other than the media.
Mm-hmm.
And I know it's very difficult to get someone to change their beliefs. You know, Mark Twain once said, and I've said many times on this show, it's much easier to trick someone to convince someone that they've been tricked. And believe me, we know this more than anybody, because we've been trying to help people see their way through this maze for a long time. And I think that when you're going into the arena where you're going to want to get people to accept information that you think will help us all out, not that you're right and that they're wrong, but this information will help them and us out, and it's for the good of us and us individually and collectively. So I think it's really important that you understand that their ego is going to have a tendency to hold on to what they believe, because it's easier to fool someone than to convince them that they've been fooled. And that's so profound, because once you dig your heels in on something, you know, I don't believe that there's life on Mars. No matter what you show me, I'm not going to be convinced. Once they dig their heels in, it's almost impossible to convince them what's really happening or to change their mind. So you have to take into account that there's an ego involved. Also, to get people to wake up in these organizations is going to be a really difficult thing, because, of course, they have ego invested, they have their whole life invested, they're probably supporting their wife and kids, they work for the CIA, they work for the CDC, actually the same thing. They're lifelong Democrats, they work for a company, they work for a weapons manufacturing company, you know, those people have to realize that they're involved in this too. And they have to kind of admit what they're doing isn't helping mankind, and stop what they're doing and help us bring this thing to a screeching halt. It's got to come to a screeching halt. Now, you're going to say, well, that would collapse the economy. Nobody would work it. That wouldn't collapse anything. People would just move to different types of work, different types of endeavors. Listen, the war business, contrary to popular opinion, maybe it's popular opinion, doesn't produce anything. It blows shit up. Maybe it creates the opportunity for more buildings so it can blow more shit up. But create things to blow it up doesn't sound like progress to me. It sounds like we should be liberating patents, building ourselves a whole new civilization here, taking away the type of slavery that's imposed by a monetary system, get ourselves into another kind of a system. But I think the toughest one is going to be the policemen, the people that are actually have to go out and enforce this stuff. And they're getting a lot of nice toys now. They're getting nice big trucks, and they're getting body armor. They look like RoboCops now, except they're in black. You guys know that you have to be in black to actually participate in their rituals, don't you? You know that your dressing in black isn't just a random pick of colors. You're dressing in black because they need that. They need you to be in that to be appropriately dressed for the rituals that you're going to take, the bloodbath rituals that you're going to take part in. That's why you have black uniforms now. You're working, you need, listen, police forces, the way governments and organizations are set up now, they really do need security forces. Maybe they won't need them in the future, but right now they really need them. And right now we really need security forces to bring under control the CIA, to bring under control the CDC and their vaccines, to bring under control any of the other atrocities that are going on. Arresting the perpetrators at Sandy Hook, or arresting people that have been posing as imposters to get this whole ball rolling. I think it'll be easy to arrest the low-level people in these crimes, and I think they'll implicate higher and higher levels. So I think eventually we could get all the way up to George W. Bush for this torture program, and his plausible deniability claim is not going to cut much weight for anybody. All right, so anyway, that's the end of my little tirade on what we should be doing in terms of the system. I wanted to get into another topic, and I want to suggest something that I've noticed, and I want to explain it to you so that these different points of view can be better understood. Okay, I don't think, you know, I was just speaking with a friend and we were talking about how the people that were committing these torturous acts could have been us. You know, maybe they were victims of circumstances. Maybe they came in with kind of a brutal tendency in their makeup. Maybe they were brutally beaten by their parents. You know, we don't know what their situation was. We have never walked in their shoes. I know I have people that are close to me that are involved in fracking. But I know exactly why they're involved in fracking, because it's more, in their view of reality, it's more dignified, prideful, what's another good word for that one? It's more honorable. It's more honorable to have a job, even though you're working, you're destroying the water table in fracking and polluting the air, I guess now. We were told yesterday that it really stinks in Colorado because of that. But you find it more honorable than to either not working against the system, or being creative and doing something else. I think that's how people justify being part of this. And I think that we really need to stop justifying it that way and really get into. But people see things differently. And I was just talking to a really crack researcher. And I was noticing his process for analyzing what things happen. In school in the United States, we're taught to analyze, which is a process where you take things apart and look at their different component parts. And we do that no matter what's presented to us, to see if it's true, to dispel the magic. We analyze. We automatically do that. So if somebody's handed an article, they go through the article and they look for different points that might be in contention. They look for the names of people who may not be trusted or might have a little shady background. And they go deep into this analysis trap. I call this vertical analysis, where they go deeper and deeper and deeper into these traps. And I think that's good. But it's only good if it's used in conjunction with what I call horizontal analysis, which is actually synthesis. So in order to see a picture of what's going on and get clear in what's going on and what you're seeing, analysis doesn't tell you. And now vertical analysis only goes deep into what's going on. And I'll give you an example. A few weeks ago, I sent an article that I had read and obviously liked, approved of, thought the sources were pretty good, to a friend of mine who has young children. And this article was about sexuality in the school, how Common Core is focusing on sexualizing young kids. They're teaching them to masturbate early and it just seems to rub up against everything that we find proper in children. Children are the innocents. They're the ones we protect. But after looking at the article, the person thanked me for the article but said, yes, I'd seen that before a few months back or a month back, but the photograph shown is not as depicted. It's actually a sex education class, which it was. It was probably about an eighth grade sex education class, judging by the people in the class. But that caused her to discount the whole article. So the article, she had done her research, she had done her analysis, and she found that by reason of one error, that the whole thing was suspect and threw it out. Now, Mindy and I have been researching that same topic for years. We're pretty up to date on it. But we research it not only vertically, but we research it horizontally. So this particular thing they're doing with Common Core, how does this relate horizontally to the pedophilia scandals that are taking place in the United Kingdom? Oh, United Kingdom, throughout the world. How does that relate to Kevin Annett's work with the Catholic Church? How does that pedophilia relate to the number of child kidnappings in the United States? You know, they don't even track that. You have to go state by state. And you're going to find that millions of kids are kidnapped and never turn up again. Anyway, I digress. How does that relate to Satanism and Laurel Canyon? They're all related. They all use children. They're all control. They're based in the control system. The control system runs them all. So the vertical analysis in that case might have been a little suspect, but I think I would have dug deeper if I was her. But the horizontal research shows a clear pattern. So that's what I'm suggesting. I'm suggesting that some people naturally do horizontal research. I think I'm one of them. I had to really be taught to do the vertical research in school, and I don't think I'm a natural at that. I think I had to learn that. People that are more right-brained, I think, have a tendency to see associations and can see point A, point C, and point D, see how they all relate. It doesn't have to be in a sequence. I think people that are more left-brain dominant, the left-brain dominants do well in public schools because that's what they teach. So I think that what we all need to do as people is learn to do both and appreciate and value both. You know, if you know somebody that's a right-brainer and that's how they do analysis, they see things that you don't, you guys should be getting together and looking at it together. You know, this is my horizontal research, this is my vertical research, and so I wanted to bring that in because we run into this all the time. You know, passing on a piece of information that you find credible that your vertical research people don't find credible at all. We're looking at things from different angles. We've got to combine them. Also, we have to feel, excuse me, that when you find something that turns out not to be credible, that you're not a bad person. You know, this is my opinion, I'll stick with it, da-da-da-da-da. Well, you better hope it's right. Because we're having opinions and making decisions that affects the whole world right now. So you better be right. So the process of taking a decision, holding the decision no matter what, doesn't help anymore.
No, things are changing way too fast. And we're learning too much information too fast. So things we learned before don't necessarily stay true and accurate. You have to be willing to say, oh, well, maybe I was wrong about that. Let's see what else.
Exactly. So I think that's the process of awakening. Maybe I've said that before in this program. I think that you're fully engaged in the awakening when you're ready to say, I may not know. And my perceptions and what I've learned and what I was taught in school may not be absolutely the truth. Mm-hmm. Maybe, but may not be. But the process of saying, I don't know, facilitates the front end of the process, which is grabbing on into information. I was talking to somebody actually yesterday also that said, yeah, I was afraid of that information, and I shied away from it because I think it could get you into some deep water. What she meant was by your analysis. And I like that idea. I like the idea of it being described as deep water because it's not deep water. If you buy someone's explanation, let's say you buy someone's story of whether the moon is populated or not, you can buy the story just based on whether you like the story and whether it fits in with your worldview. But you have to hold it lightly. It has to be a perception that you're able to let go of in a heartbeat when you find revised evidence. That's the process of awakening. It's half admitting that you don't know and half trying to get yourself out of the fear mode and into the love mode. If I would say, what are the two components of this awakening? One, it's learning, and the only way you can learn is to grab everything, hold them as temporary perceptions, and weed it out as you go. Mm-hmm. And the other thing is, transform your fear mode to a love mode.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, you're always trying to do that. You're good at finding that.
Oh, thank you. Yeah.
There's countless stories of people being in incredibly stressful situation where they've concentrated on love, compassion, looking in the eyes of their captor and seeing a human being.
Mm-hmm.
And all of a sudden the tension, the situation melts away and it's two human beings playing out their ridiculous role in this hologram. And, you know, you can modify those roles anytime you want. He just switched to love. You know, the captor could switch to love, and all of a sudden we could be sharing this wonderful environment, these beautiful plants, this wonderful air we breathe, and the planet we live in. And,
And it's a beautiful place, and it can all change right inside your very own head. And I know that one of the very best ways to change that is to find yourself in the experience of gratitude. It's a miracle what happens. And the fear goes away and love comes through, which is our natural state. I mean, the fear's induced, it's invoked on us.
Right. Boy, I had an experience with that gratitude thing. Remember, I don't know, maybe 4 or 5 months ago, everybody in the New Age community, I mean, everybody that's just, I don't know, riding the white horse or something, will tell you, be in gratitude.
Mm-hmm.
You know, be in gratitude. And I thought, well, that's really nice. Yeah, be in gratitude. And then I saw an impactful video by Snorster. It was all about gratitude. And it's about a 10-minute video. I mean, what can you say about gratitude in a 10-minute video? Well, he changed my perspective about gratitude in a 10-minute video. He, actually, I'm just going to paraphrase. The way it was to me, he described gratitude as like an ocean. Not like, oh, I'm grateful for my house. I'm grateful for my food. I'm grateful. No, it's an ocean. It's a deep, deep, deepest ocean. When you get into it, when you break the surface and you start feeling gratitude, it brings more gratitude in. And you find more things within that to be grateful for, and more things within your life that you're grateful for. And the things that you're afraid of just don't seem to be around as you go deeper and deeper into the dark arms of this wonderful state of mind called gratitude. So I'm very grateful to Snortster, and it was probably written by Less Visible. I don't know who it is.
It might have been.
And I really can get into that, and it does transform the day. And when you start swimming in that deep, dark, warm pool of gratitude, it changes your day. And that's all you have is today. So, anyway, so that's about all I have to say. Talk for a couple hours.
Yeah, I guess we are coming down to about the last 3 or 4 minutes of this episode of The World Beyond Belief.
Right, we don't do our reviews anymore. So, why don't we just say adios?
We could do that. We hope you'll join us again next week for the next episode of The World Beyond Belief, and
visit us.
Visit our blog. This is a labor of love, and I don't know quite what to say about it, but it's got some interesting features on there. In fact, a place called Gratitude is highlighted on one of the tabs of the blog called Art.
Right.
Because it was so artfully done. I thought it deserved its own category, but
we even have humor on that. I want to tell him that we just interviewed an amazing guy named Ole Damegaard, and his interview is going to be up on our website and our YouTube channel, along with our interview of Karen Tostada, who's another totally amazing woman. Ole's not a woman, it's a man.
Right.
But Karen is a woman.
You should have said another amazing person.
Yeah.
Very beautiful, very inspiring people, and out there doing, you know, working on behalf of all of humanity to make
right
the world a better place for us. And I think one of the things that Ole said today in the interview was so inspiring, and that is that really it all starts within the change. And we need to each take a look at ourselves and see what part we're playing to contribute to the ongoing nature of the world as it is today, and kind of examine that.
Right. Well.
Anyway, well, that's it for now, unless you have something else to say.
I'll pick up a copy of Belief Magic.
Oh, Belief Magic is such a fabulous book, and we hope you'll each go out and get a copy of Belief Magic and read that book. And listen, if you can't afford to buy it, write to us, because I'll be happy to send you a PDF version of it for free, because we'd love for you to read the book and know
how to free your mind.
How to free your mind. How you've been conditioned and controlled and continue to be so until you realize it and can walk away from it. So, excellent book.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
And
all right, until next week, be in a state of love. Don't be afraid. And be nice to one another.
Right.
We'll see you next time.